relive, relieve, reboot. Now, those aren't words that I ever thought I would have to grapple with personally, because those really aren't words that would come to mind if I had to describe my life for a large part of it. I was never a kid who was confused about what she wanted to do. I was never one of those kids. I knew what I didn't want to do. I knew that I didn't want to be what my grandmother wanted me to be, which was a doctor. And I knew that I liked to read books. So it was without much mental agony that I happily, easily chose the humanities stream. Then a year before I sat for my board exams, a new journalism program opened up at the Lady Shriram College University, and which was and remains and still is one of India's finest institutes of higher education today. Now, television journalism had just started off in India, and I grabbed the opportunity. And even though I had been accepted into other courses, there were the history honors that I'd been accepted into at St. Stephen's and other universities, I was much more confident about this program because I was convinced that, you know, in addition to gaining academic knowledge, I was being trained in a profession, and it is an exciting profession. So I decided to study journalism. I sat for the entrance exam, and I was one of 18 students who were chosen into the program. Then I landed my dream job straight out of college at NDTV. And while this may seem strange to a lot of millennials, the fact is that this is the only job I've ever held. It is the only place I've ever worked at. And that's because, you know, I entered the industry at a time when it was on the cusp of a boom. And I was working hands down at the best media organization in the country. I never needed to switch jobs. I never needed to switch careers to get, you know, more challenges, more opportunities, a salary hike. I was working at the organization that was hands down acknowledged and still is as being one of the best employers in the country. People would be leaving their jobs at their firms if they could to join mine, not the other way around. And the opportunities given to me then would be unthinkable for anyone entering the television industry today, given how saturated it is. Now, 23, I was anchoring a primetime 10 p.m. show called Crime and the City. So I had no need ever to reboot or reinvent. Then, thanks to my NDTV experience, I applied to graduate schools in the US. I got accepted in a few leading graduate schools in the US, and I decided to accept and go to the journalism school at New York University, in part also to do another journalism degree, in part also because they offered me a full scholarship, and I told myself that, look, New York City would be the education. Then in the years that followed, as the US Bureau Chief, I covered both the 2008 and the 2012 presidential elections. I became one of India's first journalists to visit Guantanamo. I've covered the Oscars from the red carpet. I have I've covered G20 summits. I've interviewed Salman Rushdie. I've interviewed Bill Gates, you know, the Twitter founder, Evan Williams, Preet Bharara, you name it, like all sorts. And I also managed to find the time to be in a serious relationship that has now culminated in a marriage. My timing in the US was perfect. I was at the center of the biggest news story of the decade. I was covering the US at a turning point in the country's history when they were about to elect, and they did elect, their first African-American president. Whether it was the Indo-US nuclear deal, whether it was the economic downturn, whether it was Slumdog Millionaire winning 8 Oscars that year, whether it was the trial of Rajat Gupta because of insider trading charges on Wall Street, India was at the center of every story. And every day, I was working every day. Every day was a challenge. Every day was exciting. It was a new opportunity. And I could have gone on forever. Then, for the first time, really, disruption hit. And it hit on 3 major fronts on this charmed path that I was on. And over the last few years, for the first time in my life, really, I've had to struggle with questions of rebooting, reliving, rethinking, both professionally and personally. So first, let me talk about personally. So I got pregnant. And when I finally got over the shock of that, I started going through my reading list. And of course, it went from everything from Rujuta Divakar's advice on how not to pack on the pounds, of course, I can see other moms here who are agreeing, to Pamela Druckerman's hilarious Bringing Up Baby. And then of course, I reread that controversial, infamous 2012 Atlantic article by Anne-Marie Slaughter that said why women still can't have it all. Now, remember, I am an Indian woman born and brought up in cosmopolitan parts of India. I came of age in post-liberalized India, so I had never experienced any gender discrimination, not at school, not at home. I'm one of two sisters. I went to an all-women's college. I work at an organization that has always broken the stereotype because we have women in senior posts of management. We've always had that. Naive, stupidly overconfident, you know, clueless a bit then about what was in store for me, I was dismissive. I vowed that I'm going to prove her wrong, that I could, in fact, like I had until now, I could have it all. And then I found out that I was wrong. For the first time in my life, I found that I was professionally constrained because of biology on the account of the fact that I was a woman. And this was despite working at a workplace that was and is the most women-friendly organization in the country. We have, you know, a creche in the office. We have very generous maternity leave benefits. We have opportunities to do flexible work arrangements, you name it. It was despite having a husband who was very supportive of my professional aspirations, who was willing to help with child rearing at home. This is despite having grandparents who live a 10 minutes drive away from my home. It turns out that the burden of being a senior anchor at NDTV and being the prime caretaker, the warrior-in-chief, the planner-in-chief for my two daughters was something that I was not able to bear and something had to give. At that point of time, for the first time in my life, I had to make some choices. And I went back and I made peace with what Randy Zuckerberg calls the entrepreneur's dilemma. That there are five things that most working women want in their lives. Family, career, sleep, friends, health and fitness, and you can't have it all. You gotta pick. You pick three. Three is what you get. What was I going to pick? My real education came then that life is about making choices. You know, there was this very successful executive, hedge fund executive, who told me once at a party in Connecticut, she said that the best decision he had made professionally was to have her child early in life. She said that she had her child at 23, and now in her early 30s, she was scaling the career, the ladder. And my only question was that how can you have a child at 23 when you don't know who you are at 23, when you forget about finding the right guy you want to marry and the man you want to have a child with? So I've had my children late in life, and the advantage of that is that you get advice from a lot of friends who've done this before you. And the one piece of advice that really stuck to me, that really resonated with me and also affected my gut, was that that if you want to spend a lot of time with your friends, if you also want to put in those long hours at work in order to get that promotion, if you also want to see every Oscar-nominated movie that's been released in the theaters, you want to be able to work out, you want to be able to sleep, you want to have a child, you want to be able to exercise, sorry to burst your bubble, ladies, that is not happening. Family, success, money, professional satisfaction, sex, or sleep, you've got to pick. Take your pick and make peace with your decisions. Now, at the same time, the second big disruption happened in my life, and that's really because the industry changed on me very rapidly. As you probably know, people's television viewing time in India and the world has dropped drastically over the last 5 years, and news is increasingly now consumed on social media. News organizations in this new world, we have far less bargaining power with the advertisers. They typically account for a bulk of our revenue. Our viewers are spending less time on us. Advertisers have many alternative sources to reach the viewer, and so the revenue pie for television news has shrunk, and this has resulted in a significant tightening of budgets at news organizations, and we have fewer resources available. The quality of the news, the product that we're putting out, definitely has been affected. I'm not going to lie. All news organizations have seen significant cuts to the staff over the last few years. It generally also means lower salary increases, if any. And it's an increased work burden for those of us who are still left on the rolls. And things have changed. 20 years ago, if you asked a graduating batch what they wanted to be when they grew up, a large percent, quite a few would say, there would be certainly a few who would say, I want to be a journalist, I want to be a news anchor, I want to be a news reporter. Today, those very people may be looking at the same industry and at the same profession with distrust. So the question was, should I stick it out? Should I stick it out in an industry and an organization that I love? Or albeit one that has, you know, greatly diminished economic prospects relative to what it offered when I first entered the industry. And then the third big disruption was political. Now, I grew up in a military home. Both my father and my grandfather, they are from the armed forces. I'm Syrian Christian. I'm proud of my ancient religious heritage and my Malayali culture. But above all, we were raised to be staunch Indian nationalists. We celebrate Christmas and Easter, but we were equally enthusiastic about Diwali and Holi. My daughter calls her aunts Masi. She doesn't say Kochama as we do in Kerala. And the nationalism of Hindutva, which has taken India by storm over the last 5 years, really was both strange and disquieting for me. So as an anchor, as a news, at a news channel that stands for liberal secular values, I knew it's not going to be easy. I've been anchoring since 2002. I've been on social media for a decade, but it was only after 2014 that I found myself being attacked, even abused, on the account of either my gender or my religion. For the first time, I found my views and my opinions dismissed because I'm a woman or because of my religion. It is discomforting to wake up on Christmas and be told on Twitter by a complete stranger who won't even use his own name that you and your family should die in a bomb blast. This is all part of a larger campaign of harassment, of intimidation, of liberal journalists, and the few news organizations who are still left in the country who are still doing their job. And their job is to be a watchdog for the people to question the government when it's needed. Now, in this environment, I had to ask myself, how do I respond? Do I go with the flow? Do I become a bhakt? Which will certainly increase my ratings, will certainly possibly make me more popular, and I'll have more people coming up to me asking for selfies. But it would be revolting for my conscience. Or do I become an activist journalist? Do I associate myself, align myself with a particular political ideology or a particular movement? Or do I just quit journalism like many of my friends and colleagues have done? So it was time to reboot, and for that, I had to rank my priorities. So first and foremost, I was sure that I wanted to spend maximum time with my kids. And this is why that story came back to me about what that hedge fund analyst said to me at that party. And that advice that my friends who've had kids before me gave me was that you don't want to lose 1 minute with your kids when they're young. The second important priority was that work was important to me. Yes. Because of the money, but also more importantly, because it gave me a sense of relevance beyond my home and my friends. And if I had to be really honest, then I would say that because I work, it makes me a better mother. Because I work long, hard hours, when I'm at home with my daughters, I'm not distracted. I'm not, you know, desperate to know what's happening, to check my gadgets, to know what's happening in the world, what's happening in the news. And because I work, this childcare and child rearing really feels like less of a trap. So I ended up making the following choices. Now, first, although it's stressful, I said I was going to go back to work and I'll go back full time because I've seen a lot of people have chosen the part-time option. It doesn't seem to work out, it fizzles out, and it seems to be a transition path to exiting the workforce. And then I've structured my offs in such a way that I have an off on Tuesday and Wednesday, which means that my children have a full-time parent 4 days of the week because my husband's office is closed on the weekends. Now, this, is a big negative for my social life, but remember that Zuckerberg 5, you have got to pick something. Third, I said, I will continue with journalism. The reason to enter journalism was not the money. And to leave now at a time when there are so few of us, when the voices are fading, and simply because I might be able to get or land a better job with a higher salary elsewhere was not a choice that would sit well with me. And last, I said that I would like to, you know, rise above the din. I'm not going to contribute to the din. I added a line to my Twitter bio. It says that I don't engage with trolls or abusers, and I've tried to stick to this. I was going to be doing, and I said I would do old-fashioned journalism, objective, fact-based journalism, regardless of whether this is what the audience wants to hear right now or not, whether it would appeal to the audience. And I can't say a lot of this has been easy. I work much harder than I expected to at my age. I earn much less than I expected to and I'd like to at my age. I have very little time for friends. I have much less time than I'd like for fitness. I barely get to see my husband at all, though a lot of friends tell me that is an excellent recipe for a happy marriage. But I have rebooted, I am reliving, and I've done that by relieving myself of expectations. Thank you.